he will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to kick the law. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Sorry about that. We had a technical issue there. So I decided to start the show over because it happened to be right at the beginning of the show. It actually showed me an error on Spreaker, and I was only about 2 minutes into the show, so I figured I'd start it over. So for everybody who started listening and then was like, what the fuck, everything just went out, we had a technical issue there. So welcome to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is July 12, 2016, and we are coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, and you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com into the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, and SoundCloud, and the next day on Stitcher and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty and self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we, of course, are always happy to hear from you. You can reach us via phone at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or via Skype, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. It's all one word. Just send a contact request and your name and what you want to talk about. And you can also get all that information and a lot more at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, where we have links to all of our Facebook and other social media pages. Also, the archives are posted every weekend, and we have original articles, blogs, pictures, show descriptions, and things like that. So be sure to check us out there. So as I was, as I had started to do before I had that minor issue, was talk about how over the weekend I tried to stay away from government media because every time I turned it on, I wanted to fucking punch the wall because of the way they present things as opposed to, I mean, in general, the way they present things makes me sick, but they go to, you know, this 24-hour coverage. And I did watch some Thursday night till I got to the point where I couldn't watch it anymore, but I wanted to know what was going on. But it's totally distorted. And the comparison from when a regular person gets shot, I'm going to say regular person, but when a non-fucking law enforcement or government agent gets shot compared to anybody else, it's like the end of the world when a cop gets killed. When anybody else gets killed by a cop, it's totally different. Like, you know, they're the bad person. Everything they've done in their life comes up, their high school diploma, they got copies of that, where they went to college, if they did, where they worked. I mean, it's like the NSA releases a file to the media. I mean, seriously. And maybe they do, you know, who knows. But these officers, there's nothing negative said about them. They could have been fucked up people. They could have been written up a bunch of times. They could have had tons of complaints against them. And no, you just get, well, they served in the army and they did this and they did that and whatever. And it's just the distortions and the way they talk about them, it just, the coverage with government media just makes me sick. Now, I'm not saying that what happened is a positive thing, and I'll get more into detail, and I'm sure some people will get mad at me, and I want to try to look at this more from a calm kind of analytical standpoint as opposed to an emotional standpoint. Although right before the show, I was watching the end of Anderson Cooper because anything else I could get from government media to talk about or criticize, I wanted to get. I felt like, you know, the weekend I didn't really want to watch anything. But, you know, today and yesterday I was like, okay, you know, I can watch this shit now. But they weren't really covering as much. But I caught the end of Anderson Cooper. I wish I knew that they were going to be talking more about it. But they had the wife on of one of the cops, and she had, I mean, I understand it was her husband and he got killed. And of course, she's going to be, you know, upset. But she was talking, you know, about him like this guy was like Superman and how great he was, and that some people want to be cops, but they can't. But, you know, he's like, he would save anybody, and he tried to take his shirt off and, you know, heal his own wounds and all this shit. And, you know, then she started crying a little, but it was like, I mean, she reminded me of a fucking cop, the arrogance there, like this guy's super cop and all of this shit. And of course, you know, Anderson Cooper said that, you know, people around the country are moved because of what the officers did. What the officers did was defend themselves against a gunman, essentially. And there were how many officers? And supposedly, and I find this hard to believe, but who knows? And we'll get into this later in the show. One guy with a semi-automatic rifle. And every time I hear assault weapon, it pisses me off because there is no such fucking thing as an assault weapon. I just want to ask those people, explain to me what an assault weapon is. You know, if you want to say a military style, that doesn't bother me as much. But it's not really, you know, it's not an automatic, which is when you pull the trigger back and it keeps shooting. And there's not, I keep telling people this every time it comes up, but you can have the exact same gun, essentially, where according to the assault weapons ban in 94 would be legal, but the other gun, an AR-15, wouldn't. And it's because what they define an assault rifle as, and it depends on, you know, some states have put in assault rifle, quote unquote, bans. It depends on, like, if it has a certain grip, if it has, like, these features on it that really don't make that much of a difference. So what they did was on one of these gun shows, and I mean on TV, they put together a gun based on what would be legal compared to their assault rifle ban, I think, that they had in 94. And pretty much put together the same gun. It just looked a little different because it didn't look as, like, intimidating, you know, and they used brown, like, wood as opposed to plastic and shit like that. And really, it was pretty much the same gun. It was just ridiculous. It's just they look at these guns and get scared because the way they look and don't realize that even under the assault rifle ban, you could pretty much get the same guns. So it's just ridiculous. But anyway, they love to say that. That's what they said. He had an assault rifle. Just like there's no such thing as a, well, no, there is a such thing as a clip, but a clip is not the thing that holds all the bullets that clicks into the gun. That's not a clip. That's a magazine. A clip is actually like a bunch of a plastic thingy that holds a bunch of bullets together. So they get that wrong too, but that's just more not knowing, and I didn't know that for a while. But calling it an assault rifle, that's just a matter of opinion, because again, it's a legal term, and you'd have to go and look at the specific design of the gun to determine whether it's a fucking assault rifle or not. It's just it pisses me off. Anyway, so as I was saying, I'm trying to be as unemotional as possible, but that just pissed me off. Just that, I understand her husband just died. If she was on there crying and saying bad things about the guy who killed her, it wouldn't have bothered me at all. The fact that she talked about her husband like he was a god because he was a cop, and so many people want to be cops, but they can't do it. They can't do what he does because he's Superman. And it just, it fucking pisses me off, because I know a lot of the shit that cops do. And for people that don't know, and I've went through this a whole bunch of times, so I don't want to go in great detail. I've had a lot of experience with cops, unfortunately. Even in instances where I didn't end up getting in any trouble, but it's not, you know, when I was 16, I had a cop try to, for no reason, only because I misunderstood what he said, that I couldn't park somewhere, and I was sitting in a car. He tries to fucking put his hand through the car. I was a little skinny 16-year-old, and strangle me, choke me. And that was just one instance. And that was something where I didn't even do anything. And I've had too many experiences with cops from a bunch of different states. And none of them were good that I can think of offhand. There was one cop I talked about before that I met off duty. They used to go to Buffalo Wild Wings and watch Monday Night Football. And he was pretty cool, but he was an airport cop. Not to say that he wasn't a full-fledged cop. He was, but he wasn't out there, you know, doing a lot of the shit that cops are doing, obviously, because he was just, you know, at the command at the airport. But He was a pretty cool guy, but I didn't meet him in a circumstance when he was on duty. I met him, like, I didn't know he was a cop till he told me. So it wasn't like, you know, and I'm sure there's a lot of cops. I've said this before. When I say all, I believe all cops are bad, because all cops are kidnappers, because they violate people's rights and kidnap them. And I've talked about self-ownership and all these laws that are essentially, they're not illegal, but I would say they're unconstitutional. They're also, never mind the Constitution, because that's not where your rights from. They violate your natural rights. But cops arrest you for them anyway, which means I view them as kidnappers, and kidnappers are criminals. So on the job, they're all criminals, or they have been. Because I could say, like, a homicide detective is probably not arresting, you know, kids smoking weed or people doing drugs or whatever. They're actually arresting people you would hope that have killed people. But to get to that point, they must have kidnapped people. And I would consider kidnapping people a violation of their rights, which would be anything that victimless crimes, drugs, things like that. And I know a lot of people would disagree with me. Well, that's the law, so they have to. First of all, cops have discretion. And there's an article about it in the Free Thought Project, actually. They don't have to arrest you for drugs if they don't want to. I mean, they were fucking cops. I talked about last week. It's funny because when I was doing the show, I didn't realize that's when the shootings in Dallas started going on. And then after the show, my friend had mentioned it to me, and then I started watching CNN for a little while, and then I could only stand so much. But I did a show on what I called criminal cops, although I consider kidnapping, you know, those criminal cops too, but criminal in a different sense where they actually sell drugs and things like that. And there's this documentary I watched called The 175, which was based on the 175 precinct in New York and this cop, Michael Dowd, who was a drug dealer who would accept money from drug dealers to protect them, who would commit robberies of drug dealers. You know, all of these things like that. And he talked about, you know, even though I know he was trying to protect other cops, because one minute he kind of says it like, you know, all cops are dirty, essentially. But then he's like, well, like 20%. But maybe 20% are as dirty as he is. But he even said that you need to prove that you're good. Meaning that you need to prove to your partner that they can do something illegal in front of you and it's cool, like take money from somebody's house or steal drugs from a drug dealer or something like that. So, and I have no problem with people selling drugs, but if cops are going to arrest people for it, it's the hypocrisy. So that is obviously my problem there. But I did a show about that on Thursday, and I didn't realize what was going on in Dallas was going on until after. But it's fucked up how this lady, I understand. I mean, people deal with their grief differently, but I wish I had the clip because it was just like, the way she talked about it was just, you know, and the way they even covered this, and I'll get to it in more detail. First of all, this was a shooting. Some people want to call it a terrorist attack. Some people want to call it other things. But I know a woman got injured, and you know that was by accident because it was a black woman as well. He was trying to kill cops, obviously, because if you look at it, there was a whole bunch of people there who were the ones who got killed, all cops. you know, except for, I think, one lady got shot in, and it was in the leg, too. So it wasn't, and she's there gushing like, oh, this cop helped me. But for Anderson Cooper to say that what they did there, that it, I think almost, I'm kind of paraphrasing, but it's pretty close to his exact words, that it moved people all over the country or all over the world, what the cops did. And what moved anybody? You have the whole Dallas police force at your disposal, and the SWAT teams obviously came. And one guy with a gun. Now, I know it was what they call an assault rifle. First of all, police have automatic AR-15s. Like, they have, like, M16s. I don't know if, I guess there would be fully automatic AR-15s, but I don't think that's what they call, if they're fully automatic, I don't know that that's what they call them as far as what the military uses. But whatever the military uses, the cops have it. And they had their fucking tank out there, too. And this is another excuse, oh, well, we need tanks. Now, first of all, the cops feel that there's a war on cops now all of a sudden, even though I believe last year the amount of cops killed, and I'm talking about being killed, not, you know, dying on the job in a car accident, went down. Crime in general went down. You had this doctor saying that the killing needs to stop or something like that. And, yeah, I mean, it's not a positive thing for people to get killed. It's not a positive thing for people to die in general. But if you look at statistics, things are going down, and they have been going down. And this is where the media comes into play, because the people that follow the fucking media think that, I mean, government media think all these things that aren't even the case, because the truth is things are getting safer. Things are getting, crime is going down. Murder's going down. So, and as far as the police, so once a year, cops get or one person a year or something like that targets police. I mean, really, over the past couple years. And then before that, it had been like years. Like a New York, I think in the past like 10 years, you had the two New York cops that were killed. I don't know if it ended up in 2014 or 15, because it was either early in 15 or late in 14. But the biggest police department in probably the world, for a city, I think that they didn't have anybody get killed, get murdered for years, for like 5 years at least, if not more. And then they had two cops that were targeted. But the majority of cops that are killed, they had some cops, and this is what it's going to do, too, because, of course, now the media is going to mention stuff that they wouldn't normally. So they brought up, one, a guy who tried to escape from a courthouse, and the gun that he got was the cop's gun. So, you know, whose fault is that? And I don't think anybody died, but I believe I heard just a little of the story, but I do know for a fact it was someone that was in custody and was trying to escape and got the cop's gun and shot them. So they cover that, of course, as like a national story, because this was in Michigan. And then today, they cover a story. First of all, they have, oh, there was some plot in New York or whatever. I Was it in New York? I heard something about some plot, whatever. But they cover a cop some cops getting shot at in a carjacking. And then they have to, of course, say at the end of it, they weren't targeting the cops. So meaning that there's a lot of cops that get shot at or get killed in the commission of a crime. And the reason why they get shot at or killed is not because the guy's like, hey, I want to go shoot some cops. It's they're trying to get away and the cops are shooting at them and they shoot back. So, of course, something that they probably wouldn't have mentioned nationally, a carjacking, the cops didn't get killed. I think one of them got shot. They bring up, whereas before the Dallas shooting, they wouldn't bring up. Now, the fact that they killed five officers, I think, is the factor that makes this bigger than some of the other stories. But I mean, the shooting here in Las Vegas in 2014 and the one in New York that, again, was either at the end of 2014, I think it was 2015. It was two cops that were killed. So in this case, there were three more. But even with that, I believe they're still at the same, you know, pace for how many cops get killed per year, which is like 40 or between 30 and 40. And again, almost all of them are based on what I just said in the commission of a crime, not a targeting of cops. So this whole thing and this cops feel people are scared, you know, cops are scared now and feel people are at war with them. Well, you had those two, the father and son who got pulled over and were quote unquote sovereign citizens and killed a couple cops. And they used that for years to try to scare cops. The Southern Poverty Law Center did a video. They're actually involved with the government where they train police and they scare the shit out of them that, oh, there's people, you know, that want to kill cops. But basically, the amount of times that it happens and the amount of cops that they are that exist, I mean, the total amount of police, the total amount of interactions, it's very, very rare that somebody actually targets cops. Like I said, maybe it's once a year. And that was the past couple years. And before that, it might have even been less. I mean, because they kept referring to a case from, I think, like 2005. And then based on that, they claim there's a war on cops. And that they're scared that, oh, people are trying to kill them and whatever. And it's such bullshit. What about the 1,400 people around that? And it could be even more that they kill per year. Now, I know, and I mentioned this before because it is all relative, that is that a lot of people compared to the amount of interactions they have percentage-wise? No. However, it is in the sense that it's the government killing people. So it's different to me when you look at something like that than when you look at like the amount of people that die from gun violence in percentage in comparison to the total population or total people that die, which is tiny. So to say that's a high number, even though, you know, it's probably less than 1% of the murder. Well, It's probably not, though, because if you look at the total murders and I'm trying to remember around, it might be like when I was looking at statistics, like 20,000. I mean, so it is in comparison to murders, it's still too high in comparison to other countries. And it's the fact that it's the government. It's that you can get killed by the government. And is there a high percentage that you're going to get killed by the police? It's going to go up based on the area you're in, or your race, or certain other, your age, certain other factors. But it's definitely too high because it is the government. And because it is people that supposedly are supposed to protect people, which they don't. But let's go back to what happened here. The police are getting credit like they saved all these people and they're out there to protect people and all of this shit. And they were the target. If you weren't a cop, you really didn't have to worry. Just as long as you're not standing too fucking close to one and get hit by accident, which happened. Besides that, he was targeting cops. And then they brought up, well, and white people, and they tried to keep emphasizing that. Even though his stepmother is white, and they have a really good relationship. And also, one of the cops that he killed, I believe, was Hispanic as well. So this was more about cops than anything else. And the first of all, why are the police at the fucking protest? And they say to protect the people's right to protest, that the police are there protecting the people's right to protest. Because usually when the police were there in other places, it made things worse when people were protesting. They weren't there to protect the people's right to protest or to protect the people. They were there to make sure the protest didn't get out of hand like it has in other cities. And Dallas may be a lot different as far as who's protesting. But that's why they were there. And they talk about some of the people taking pictures with the cops. I don't know the total amount of people that were there protesting, but, you know, what, one or two people took pictures with cops? I doubt the majority of people were there taking pictures with cops. I mean, it's just how they skew things and want to make things look a certain way or in a certain light. So one of the things that I think struggle with in this whole, not just what happened in Dallas, but the whole Black Lives Matter, and I've done shows on them and talked about them. And first of all, people need to realize, and I actually talked about them a little on Thursday, because of the two killings that had come up that were on video, and we'll talk a little about those today. The ones they were actually protesting on Thursday. So you have these two killings by police that were caught on videotape that look like murders to me. They look really bad. And what happens, of course, is they talk about the people's records. And we'll get to that. Like one of the guy, they'd say, oh, he's a convicted sex offender. Then you find out, well, he was 20 and the girl was 14. I know some people would have a serious problem with that, but I honestly don't. I mean, there's 14-year-old girls that look like they're 21. And a 20-year-old with a 14-year-old, assuming that, you know, she's already gone through puberty and everything, which most girls by 14 have these days. I don't see an issue with that. That's a, you know, of course, as long as it was consensual, and from what I understand it was. So it was a statutory rape charge. He did do a couple other things from what I recall, but that's what happens. A guy gets killed by the police and they don't talk about any of the good things. They search for all the bad stuff, throw it out there. This guy's, you know, I didn't hear anything bad about any of the police that got killed. You mean to tell me they've never done anything bad? None of the five police have ever been, there's never been any complaints of excessive force or anything like that in the time that they have been on the force. Excessive force on the force. So you're not going to hear that part of it, of course, because they don't do that. But anyway, so that's what they were protesting. The reason, obviously, the cops were there, which they shouldn't be there. I don't believe, I think that's, in a sense, instigating. Now, nothing happened from the protesters, but obviously something happened. And if they weren't there, then obviously nothing would have happened because he would have had no cops to shoot at. But regarding Black Lives Matter, as I was saying, there's about four people a day at least that get killed by the police. Now, not all of them are unarmed, but as I have said before, I took like a sample of, you know, I think it was 60 or 70 people and went through, got them from the articles from Killed by Police, but then also searched each one of them for multiple sources. So I just didn't have whatever article Killed by Police posted. So what Killed by Police does is every time somebody is killed by a police officer, they'll post an article of the mention of the killing by the police officer. So whether they, you know, shot at the police officer or it was in the commission of a crime or whatever it was, they'll still post it. So I had mentioned before that I only believe a justified killing by a police officer, even though I don't believe police should exist. And that's, we'll talk about that later, but that's one of the reasons why I have my Facebook page and the government police and did a, used to do a weekly show of Nonpartisan Liberty for All, but called it, you know, and the government police Thursday, because I don't believe that police the way they are now should exist, and meaning that they should have the power that they have, because look what has happened from it. And nobody talks about really about all the beatings and harassment and all this other stuff occasionally, but there's so many murders that it's hard, you know. When you get beat up, you know, compare that to somebody being murdered, or you're beat up and screwed over by the justice system. No one seems to care. And I sent my story, which I've talked about on the air, to every email I could find of, you know, they have the in Las Vegas, the like sevens on your side or whatever shit like that, where they, and you look at what they cover, what happened with me was far worse than the bullshit that they cover. But they don't want to, you know, get into that because that's police. And police are great and police can do no wrong, of course. Anyway, so with Black Lives Matter, and I totally just lost my train of thought there for a minute, and what their whole agenda there is, if they had called themselves, with Killed by Police, I talked about, they post the article, and I had done a sampling and whatever, and the majority of those cases of the four people per day, I mean, I would say that more cases than not, do they have a gun? And are they in a position that I felt that the police have a right to shoot them? Especially when you have three or four cops there and you have one, like there was a little skinny, mentally ill kid that was 18 years old that had a drill in his hand and they shot him in the head. There were three cops. You know, shit like that, that happens all the time, and they get away with it all the time. And it's all races. And that's the whole thing, too, is that Black Lives Matter has totally manipulated the facts. And I'm not saying that if you're black, your chances aren't. It's like looking at, as I had said earlier, you have a higher percentage of getting killed by the police. There's no doubt. And I agree with that. And to say that people aren't racist, you know, is of course racism still exists. Just because there's a black president doesn't mean all of a sudden, oh, well, there's no racism now. Well, of course, racism still exists. And I think the place, though, where it actually makes a difference is government. That being police as well. And the court systems. And I think where it shows the most is in the court systems and with the police. Meaning the government and the government in their systems. Because the average fucking white person doesn't have the power usually to do anything and doesn't do anything anyway. Usually keeps whatever feelings they have to themselves, or maybe they talk to their white friends or something and, you know, use certain words or whatever. But it's the government that is the most oppressive and has the power to be the most oppressive. Now, do I think police go out and say, yeah, let's go like kill a black person today? No. However, there was a Las Vegas cop who his girlfriend reported, or it might have been his wife. And he used to, they end up getting divorced. And I think he went to court over him beating her. And they, of course, waited for him to get his pension. And then, like a psych pension. And then they finally fired him. It was like the only cop that's ever been fired for killing somebody. But he didn't get, you know, brought up on charges or anything. Anyway, he did. He was Hispanic. The guy he killed was black, but I don't think that had anything to do with it. I honestly think in that situation that he had an opportunity to kill somebody and that he had talked about wanting to kill somebody because he just gets a free vacation and then, you know, he'll be back on the force. But I'm not saying that every cop is like that. That obviously is a sick fuck. But yeah, he did actually get up like, I want to kill somebody today. You know, maybe not that day, but in the near future. So I don't think the average cop gets up and says that they want to kill somebody today. But they know that they can get away with it, even by law. I've read the Nevada state law. Legally, they can pretty much kill you. So I don't think cops are, you know, I do think, I've said this before, in general, the police are a racist institution. I think the courts are racist institutions as well. So does that mean, though, that just because they're racist institutions that every white person gets off and they only go after black people? No, they go after everybody. They want control. But I do think in certain circumstances that, you know, depending on certain other factors as well, like especially younger black kids that they know can't defend themselves, that they might get a harsher punishment. Yeah, I do believe that does happen. And I've seen, you know, I've talked to people when I was in jail for a couple of days while they were processing my bail. So, yeah, I do believe that that happens. However, at the same time, it's not like if you're not black that the police leave you alone and you can do whatever you want. They fuck with you just as much. They want to fuck with whoever they can fuck with. Now, I think the problem is that most police are scared punks and they think all young black kids, especially that are dressed a certain way, are criminals. And that's how they look at it. And I think that is an issue, and I think that's why a higher percentage of black people are killed by police than other races. And I mean that in terms of the amount of the percentage of population compared to, because more white people are killed by police, but that's because there's more white people in the country. But this whole thing that the issue is just racism is bullshit, because the police and the people that are attracted to those jobs harass everybody. They like having power over people. They like fucking with people. I mean, they fucked with old ladies. They fuck with whoever they can. They like it. And trust me, they'll kill anybody that doesn't obey them. And I don't mean you just disobey them, they'll just shoot you. But if it's something where they tell you to stop and you keep running, it doesn't matter if you're black or not. Now, the only thing that I think might stop them in certain circumstances, if they think that person is a person who, if they killed, they would be able to, their family, you know, has a lot of money, or they come from a wealthy family or something like that, or an important family. That would be the only reason, I think. But that's a small percentage of people. So, and it's the same with this whole white privilege. It's not, it's like rich privilege or certain, you know, 1% privilege or whatever you want to call it. However, somehow people think that have fallen into this idea that you just, you know, like cops will look at you differently, or they'll just like you, or so. I don't know what the fuck people are thinking. And you know what? The other thing is, I don't think the majority of black people even think that. To be honest, I think the majority of black people realize that it's us, the people, against the government, against the police, against the government agents. And that's what they're trying to do, is divide us. They're trying to divide people. And by doing that, it's a huge benefit to them, because what Black Lives Matter is doing is they're taking the focus off of the police being bad, having too much power, and all of these things that they get away with. And they're putting the focus on racism. To me, it's about freedom for everybody, and for people to not only, of course, not be killed by police, but to not be harassed by police, to not be arrested for ridiculous crimes by police, to not be oppressed by police. And trust me, I've had my fair share, unfortunately, as I said. I mean, the police wanted to fuck with me and had me arrested for something that wasn't even a crime. Fortunately, the district attorney dropped it because they had better things to deal with. However, I was arrested for obstruction of an officer for bullshit, had bruises all over me, and was found guilty by a judge after he looked at these pictures. Plus, the law even says intent. So, I mean, to say that they didn't fuck with me because I wouldn't bow down to them, it is bullshit. The whole thing was, you must obey us. You must do what we say, or we're going to fuck with you. And that happens to plenty of other races as well. And this whole Black Lives Matter, looking at it, who are we talking about? So if you're saying about lives mattering, they don't matter, because the whole point is saying, well, black lives don't matter, but white lives matter. Well, anytime a cop has killed a white person that's been unarmed, which has happened a lot of times as well, just as many, you just don't hear about it. They didn't go to jail neither. So the other problem is, if this is about the police, then that's one thing. If it's, and it seems like it kind of is, but then Trayvon Martin is brought into it, that had nothing to do with police. And then if you're talking about lives mattering, that's why people bring up, well, you know, 93% of black people are killed by other black people. So to me, and what I've looked at, I mean, it's more of a progressive operatives or Democratic operatives from their party have obviously, you know, back or hijacked Black Lives Matter. And I would say back them, just like Occupy Wall Street or the Tea Party or any of those. They're all taken over by political operatives, because they otherwise they might actually accomplish something. So what they're doing is saying, well, cops are racist, so we need to do something to end racism with cops. Even though Black Lives Matter is not a name that fits to me if you're just talking about police. But whatever. But what they're doing is they're helping push toward the ultimate goal of federalizing the police, like that's going to help. The Black Caucus sent a letter to President Obama a couple years ago, or maybe a little less than that, about federalizing the police. You know what federalizing the police will do? First of all, they're almost federalized already. All of this shit that they're doing is coming from the federal government. They're giving them tanks. They're giving them training and all of this stuff. What it will do is have an occupying army inside the country that will be controlled by the federal government. As opposed to focusing on the power police have and taking that shit away and stopping them from killing people and abusing people. They're just focusing on race and totally taking the focus off of what the real problem is. Because I guarantee you, one, I mean, not every white cop that kills a black person, it has to do with race. I'm sure some of them do and some of them don't. But either way, they're going to fucking kill people. If they have the power to do it, they're going to do it. Whether they're black or another race. So that's my issue with Black Lives Matter, is they're not focusing on the issue and they're pretty much ignoring the fact that the issue is police killing people, harassing people, beating people, and they're doing it to all races and all people. And that needs to stop. It needs to stop happening to black people, but it needs to stop happening to all people. And I don't sit and focus on, well, I'm just going to focus on one race and what's happening to this race. No, I want all people to be free and to not be oppressed. So to me, the media, government media, is just doing the same thing. They're only focusing. One, I mean, they didn't even talk about people getting killed by police. You'd only hear about it locally. You wouldn't hear about it nationally until people started rioting. And then they got to a point where they couldn't ignore it. And then with these two last cases, you know, with all the talk on the internet and the videos, same thing. They're getting to a point where they can't ignore some of these cases, but they're doing it in a way where they will only focus on the racism part because that's what the government wants them to do. That's the government's agenda. The government's agenda is not stopping police or taking away their power or anything like that. It's federalizing, at least that's one of their goals, is federalizing the police, which, like I said, again, creates an army, an occupying army within the United States, which we pretty much already have, but it makes it official. So I look at it as Black Lives Matter is just doing damage. But I think the majority of people, black and white, that are out there protesting aren't about Black Lives Matter. They're about the police and the killing of people. And of course, the media wants to make it look like, you know, Black Lives Matter is huge and these people are all members and that's what it's about. But I don't think the majority of people agree with everything that they stand for. I think the majority of people realize that it's us against the police or it's us against the government. And don't forget about the politicians, the district attorneys, the judges, all of these other people that are part of this. Because the police are the bottom on the bottom. They're their dogs. They're the ones that we see. They're the ones that carry out their actions. So, yeah, they're just as responsible. But the politicians are just as responsible as the police. It's like somebody that goes out and pays someone to murder somebody. That's really what it is. They're paying the police to enforce their laws. Now, the police are just as responsible because they don't have to do it. And they have discretion as well. But people forget about the politicians like they get a pass, or the judges, or the district attorneys. Like all these people are getting a pass, and they shouldn't be. And it's just the police. It goes beyond the police. And people have to realize that as well. It's the government as a whole. And the police are just the ones that are on that bottom ring. But again, they're just as responsible. So that's really, you know, what I think is the problem with Black Lives Matter. And I don't agree. And I don't know if I've talked about this before with Trayvon Martin, because that totally turned into, it went from racism, and they actually, NBC cut the fucking tape up so they could make it look like he was racist. They called him white when he's Peruvian, and he clearly looked Peruvian, and you know, he's half white, but, and it turned into being about getting rid of self-defense laws and getting rid of guns. That's what it turned into. And how one case means Black lives don't matter because he was found not guilty, and because all the police get off. All the police get off from every other race that they do anything to as well. That's the point. It's that they're getting off because they're the police. The problem is the police. Yes, again, they go after Black people at a higher percentage. And I think part of that is because they think that they can get away with it more. But they think they can get away with anything. And that they believe, like I said, they think all Black kids are criminals or something, which is, I would call that prejudice. But, you know, if you want to call that racist, then yeah. So I'm not saying that there's not racism, and definitely in the court system, there is as well. But that doesn't get to the problem or the issue, which is that the police are out of fucking control. They have too much fucking power, and they're able to do whatever they want and get away with it. And that's to anybody. But the issue is totally now when you turn on any of these government media stations, they're not talking about the police having too much power and abusing people's rights and any of that. They're just talking about racism, and that it's like, yeah, if they just got rid of the racist cops or did certain training, that's it. That's all they need to do. And no, that's not it. These motherfuckers need to be taken off the street. They should not exist. They do not accomplish what is needed, and that's protection and safety of people. And I know people will say, well, you get rid of the police. And someone made some fucking comment once, like, about, you know, being scared or whatever. I don't worry about any of that shit. I got fucking guns, too. OK, so what's the difference between me and a cop, besides the fact that they got a whole gang, because that's what they are. And, you know, that's really it. I can defend myself. I don't need a cop. But I'm not against security and people being protected and people being kept safe. And I keep bringing up the place in Detroit, the Detroit Threat Management Center, as an example of what things could be based on in a free market, and how people that couldn't afford it, they would provide for those people. So you would have protection, but you wouldn't have people that have the power to get away with killing people or get away with harassing people, because they wouldn't have those extra rights that the police have. But no one's talking about that, because they're just talking about racism. But the goal is to make sure they're not killing people and harassing people and beating people of all races. So simply just making it about race and ignoring the fact that this is happening to a lot of people of other races is not going to solve any problems or any issues. And one of the things that I talk about all the time is noncompliance. And of course, noncompliance and noncomplying with laws, that's where the police would come in. But I want to move beyond Black Lives Matter and get into what happened in Dallas, as well as these two murders by the police that really just videos went viral is what had happened. But in that time, you know, and I could go through it and look it up and look up the race of it. And I, when I did my sample thing, I did that just to make a point. But the whole thing is, there's no point in me even doing that, because I already know that it's all races and that more white people are actually killed. But I don't give a fuck about race. When it comes down to it, it's just about people. And anybody who's being, you know, people being killed by police cannot continue to happen. Not only cannot not continue to happen, but people being harassed by police, people being arrested when they shouldn't be, people being abuse of power, all of these things. But somehow that's getting lost, because government media is not going to cover that. So on that, I'm really not going to take a break. I'm going to play this clip by Rudy Giuliani. Actually, I'm going to play another clip first. Then when we come back, I'll play the clip by Rudy Giuliani, because I want to go through it. Because it's just, it is so ridiculous that it's something that I think needs to be talked about. And then we'll talk about the accused shooter who is now dead, killed by a robot bomb. And that's very convenient. But But we got a lot of stuff to talk about. So we'll talk about that. We'll talk about Obama's speech and how it's going to be exploited, whether it's him or the next person in the White House, how they're going to use this to push things like gun control and further militarize the police. We'll talk about the murders of Alton Sterling and Philando Castile, and the shooting itself, some of the conspiracy theories surrounding it, and then the actual my opinion on the whole shooting and on police in general. So we'll be here. I plan on being here till 9. We scheduled it till 9. So, and we may do a part 2 tomorrow as well, because there's a lot to talk about regarding this. Things just keep getting worse and worse. And I mean that in the sense of for the people, because they do things, they don't need a reason to do things. Like cities get these fucking tanks based on nothing. So when they have something happens, they were probably going to, you know, continue to ramp up anyway, but now they can actually use it as a reason and get people to even support them in that. So it's to me, we're in a lot of trouble if you give a shit about freedom. And I'm talking about true freedom, meaning being able to do what you want with your life as long as you don't hurt anybody else. And we're in a lot of trouble. That's I don't mean to be, you know, to bring people down and not be optimistic, but we are definitely between, you know, the terrorists that they created and, you know, who knows even about this shooting and whether this was a false flag or it was an actual shooting. Either way, they created an environment for it to happen. You know, if you keep killing people, eventually people are going to fight back. So they created an environment for something like this to happen. But so we will be right back after this. Remember, every Monday at 7 o'clock, the Illumination Hour with producer and host Ellen Stallone brings you a creative and entertaining show. So be sure to tune in to that, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, every Monday, here on Nonpartisan Liberty for All Media and Radio Network. And we'll be right back after this. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com.
Joining us right now on the phone is former Boston Police Chief Ed Davis. Also here with us is former New York City Homicide Detective Bo Dietl. Ed, to you first, your take on this horrific shooting.
Good morning, Maria. Well, this is a game changer. Police now are going to have to worry about force protection, go into a more military mode now when handling any of these demonstrations. I think it's at a time when we're trying to get closer to the community. This throws a wedge in between the police and the community we're trying to serve.
Yeah, we've been talking about that this morning. Certainly it all began with the Ferguson effect, where police were pulling back. And now you're saying going into military mode. What does that look like, Ed, in terms of the police changing their tactics?
Well, you know, having SWAT assets supporting demonstrations now, you know, we're there to protect the First Amendment rights of the people that are trying to get their point across. But now we have to be forward-looking to make sure that the officers, who in the past have been engaged in you know, minor disturbances or making sure traffic is handled properly around these events. Now we have to be cognizant of the fact that there could be a threat beyond that. And the fact that Dallas didn't have a specific incident that occurred recently, that this happened, you know, after a couple of incidents that happened in different places, makes everybody in the country nervous now.
Bo Deedle, how do you see it?
Well, first of all, my heart and soul goes out to those officers and their families. One guy was married 2 weeks, and he was killed there. This just brings back memories. I was on the police department in the early 70s when we had the Black Liberation Army. They killed 13 cops 1 year, and they killed 11 cops the next year, and they were assassinations, just what we saw. When that guy was firing with that cop, and he walks over, and he pumps three into that cop, and he was laying on the ground.
This
is assassination.
Shot him in his back.
And I'll guarantee you there was four people at least involved with this, because you had rapid fire from the rooftop from different places.
Two snipers.
He's walking around, and this was pre-planned. And if you watched his tactics, he was very well versed in military procedure. Also, when you get a president, he's leaving for NATO, and all of a sudden, before these incidents, the two incidents, hey, look, I'm not going to sit here and say, oh, these incidents look good. Let him investigate him before you judge, like you judge Ferguson, like you judge everything. I have never seen this country so divided since the 1960s, and this president's responsible. It's the leadership on the top, and I'm real upset and I'm real angry about those officers, because you notice those officers weren't running away, they were running in. Yeah. And those officers were gunned down and they were assassinated. And let's not take off the board terrorism for the fact that this would be a great opportunity for ISIS to start a civil war in America, right, and use that as a catalyst and use it as the cops against the black community. Yeah. Hey, America is not black, white, or Muslim. America is one. We're all together. And this president divided us. We got to bring ourselves together. And people got to understand, just imagine if the cops went around for 2 days. Anarchy around. People would be robbed. People being shot. Yeah. Let's stop the nonsense. Let's bring it together. And it starts from the top. We need a leader in there to bring us together. You got that blue shield there, that T-Bone Pickens wife's involved, bringing the cops into the community. There are programs. We must do this. We got to bring it together.
And yes, that's not what we heard.
So horrible.
Not what we heard from President Obama in Warsaw this morning. He talked about gun control.
And Donald Trump, when he tweeted out his message, it was measured. It was not politicized. That's the kind of message you need from a leader.
Well, you know, again, I was here in this in the late 60s, early 70s. I saw the division in this country. I've never seen it so bad, and it starts with that leadership. And you know what?
How did you fix it in New York? How did it get fixed?
People don't understand one thing also. There are millions of interactions. There are millions of interactions with the police and people over this country. Did you know 5 Caucasians were killed by cops last week? Well, you don't hear about it. When you hear a black shooting, all of a sudden it's got to be emphasized. It's got to be highlighted. I don't know what the facts were behind those things. I didn't like the way the shootings looked myself. I didn't ever kill anybody. But I'm not going to justify or judge someone until I know all the facts.
Davis, as it relates to the fact, you led the Boston Police Department during the Boston Marathon massacre. What can you take away from this incident in terms of motivation?
Well, that's an interesting question, Maria. You know, we caution people to take their time and to think about wait until the facts come out. And there have been no public statements on motivation here. But I suspect that Chief Brown, who I know and have great respect for, if this was anything but what the speculation is, they would have been out clarifying that by now. So I think that it is what it is. And tragically, we have to deal with this new reality. And police are going to be on edge now for some time after an incident like this.
Ed Davis, thank you. Bo Deedle, thank you.
Oh my God! Please, officer, don't tell me that you just did this to him.
Shots fired. Saying the suspect has a rifle.
Right now, one second, I'll get him here.
I'm Manila Chan in Washington, D.C. We have special coverage this evening after a week of violence across the country. First, an incredible scene in Dallas, Texas last night as the downtown metro area became a war zone. Peaceful Black Lives Matter activists were marching through the streets alongside Dallas police and transit authority when semi-automatic gunfire rang out. The melee caught on multiple cell phone cameras, which resulted in the deaths of 5 police officers and a standoff with a lone gunman who was eventually killed by police explosives. We've got team coverage on the ground all around the country. Simone Del Rosario is in our newsroom with the latest details. Manuel Rapolo is on the ground in Dallas. Anya Parampil is out in St. Paul, Minnesota, with the hundreds who came out in support of Philando Castile. Ashley Banks has the developments surrounding the Alton Sterling death in Baton Rouge. Let's start with Simone Del Rosario. Simone, what can you tell us?
Manila, one sniper killed five police officers at a Dallas protest last night, injuring seven others and an additional two civilians. Now, it started as a peaceful Black Lives Matter demonstration against recent police killings, just like demonstrations we saw all across the country last night. But as you can see, this turned deadly and chaotic, demonstrators fleeing from the streets while the police officers trying to protect them came under fire, several of them losing their lives. Take a listen to what this sounded like in downtown Dallas around 9 p.m. local time.
Somebody's really armed to the teeth. This is not one person with a... This is a person with a big knife.
The standoff between the shooter and police lasted several hours. In that time, 12 officers and two civilians were shot. According to the Dallas police chief, during the standoff, the shooter said he wanted to kill white people, especially white officers. He told police he was upset about recent police shootings of black suspects. Clearly, he targeted cops in his assault. This video, captured and posted to social media, shows a shooter coming around a column at El Centro College, killing a police officer at point-blank range. The sniper has been identified as 25-year-old Micah Xavier Johnson from Mesquite, Texas, outside of Dallas. He's an Army Reserve veteran who served an active duty tour in Afghanistan. He said he acted alone. Now, police ended the standoff by detonating a bomb robot, killing Johnson. This after it's believed Johnson killed five officers. We're still waiting for one to be identified. We know of four. 43-year-old Brent Thompson was a Dallas area rapid transit officer, the first DART officer to be killed in the line of duty. He married just 2 weeks ago. Michigan native Michael Kroll moved to Dallas in 2007 to follow his dream of becoming a police officer, according to his brother-in-law. He was 40. According to family members, 32-year-old Patrick Samaripo was a father and Navy veteran who served three tours before coming back and continuing his public service as a police officer. And 55-year-old Michael Smith, a father, served as an Army Ranger and went to the police academy in Dallas.
There's no possible justification for these kinds of attacks or any violence against law enforcement. The FBI is already in touch with the Dallas police, and anyone involved in these senseless murders will be held fully accountable. Justice will be done.
That was the president speaking from Poland. Police are still investigating how this attack was carried out. Though the dead suspect said he acted alone, police have had a few people in custody. After questioning them, Dallas Police Chief David Brown had this to say about the attack coordination.
This was a well-planned, well-thought-out, evil tragedy by these suspects. And we won't rest until we bring everyone involved to justice. Yes.
The demonstrations we saw in Dallas and across the country last night in response to police killings in Louisiana and Minnesota this week. Black Lives Matter and other protest organizers have come out condemning the attack on police officers in Dallas. Today, Dallas Mayor Mike Rawlings had his own message at a prayer service.
Can we as citizens speak against the actions of a relatively few officers who blemish the reputation of their high calling and at the same time support and defend the 99% of officers who do their job professionally, honestly, and bravely? This is the men and women that were shot last night. I think we can, and I think we must.
Now, Manila, we are less than 24 hours removed from when the first shots were fired in Dallas. We'll be learning more in the coming days. In the meantime, though, we remember that we have five officers killed doing their jobs last night, and nine officers and civilians are still injured from last night's ambush. Manila?
certainly a tragic chain of events. Thank you for that. That was RT correspondent Simone Del Rosario.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. And it's things like that, 99% of officers who are good, and the things they say when it comes to police and this bad apples and this all this bullshit, because that's what it is. It's bullshit. And I base that off of a number of things, unlike some people who just, how do they know that 99% of officers are good, first of all, which is, again, bullshit. Now, 99% of officers don't kill people. That I agree with, but that doesn't make them good. And, you know, based off of, one, my own experience with police in four states or five states or something like that, all of the stories and research that I've done, including, you know, former criminal cops, cops that have come out, and cops like Serbico, and all of these stories that actually have come out. And just common sense, if all of these are that have actually come out where cops have gotten caught, what about all the ones where they haven't? I mean, it's a huge percentage. And you have even the cops that are considered the quote unquote good cops. They still give people attitudes. They still harass people and treat them like shit. And so, I mean, even the cops that are considered good cops are not good cops, and they're all kidnappers, all of them. And that's why they're all bad to me as cops. And as I was saying earlier, that doesn't mean that they're bad to their family. That doesn't mean that they're bad to their kids or bad to their friends or anything like that, or their parents. But it does mean that they're bad when it comes to their job. And you know, anybody that kidnaps people to me is a criminal. So, you know, based on those things, that's how I come to that conclusion. Now, for somebody to come up and say what they say, what are they basing that off of? Now, a cop, the only person who could give you, and even when it comes to this, and they were being honest, it'd be hard because they would have to be in so many different departments because there's so many differences depending on where you are. But a cop could give you an accurate representation in their department, probably, but it'd be hard because there's probably stuff they don't know. And also, they wouldn't. You know, Serbico said the opposite. It was something like 90% of the cops were, and these were dirty cops. And I, as I did last week, I separated between, you know, cops that violate people's rights and cops that are actual criminals that go out and, you know, sell drugs or rob people or rob drug dealers or take drug money or are part of drug cartels. So to make these statements, they don't fly anymore. There are too many cops that are being found out about. And on top of that, you know that for every cop that is found out about, there's a certain amount that isn't. And it's probably a big amount because they all watch each other's back. They don't snitch on each other. And even the ones that get caught doing things, as long as it's not an actual crime, usually, like I've seen cops go to jail, like the one I was talking about for selling drugs. But when it comes to shooting somebody using excessive force, all of that stuff, all that's okay. Nobody ever goes to jail for that. So before I go through this Rudy Giuliani clip, I really haven't talked about what I think about what happened. And I don't condone, obviously, going out and shooting cops and doing what this guy did. I do understand the frustration and the feelings that people have when it comes to feeling like they're helpless and they can't do anything about it. So I understand that. But I look at it more, not just the fact that they're cops, but they are people as well. And to just start shooting at people, to me, I can't condone that, nor, I mean, I don't say that, you know, when you join a fucking gang, it's like you could be a gang member and not commit any crimes or do anything bad and end up getting killed. And people are going to be like, well, he's a gangbanger, so who gives a fuck about his life? It's almost the same thing where, you know, you join a gang, you're kidnapping people. I don't think that they deserve to die. Now, if it was one of the cops that actually had killed somebody, then that would be different. But I don't think these cops deserve to die. They might deserve to, you know, have the ass whipped or something like that. So I don't condone, you know, killing anybody unless it's in self-defense. But I understand where this guy's coming from. And I don't look at it the same way that probably most people do. You know, I look at it as somebody who felt probably, and I'm just speculating, that he didn't have any other options. And that's what he felt he had to do. It doesn't do anything. It doesn't make things, you know, I hope that it scares, yeah, I hope it scares cops in a sense that they back off people. But it won't. And that's the problem. Now, if this keeps, if it happened over and over again, which it doesn't, because most people, even that realize cops are bad, wouldn't do something like that. Like, I believe all cops are bad, but I would never do something like that. I would never just, you know, with anybody, I would never just kill somebody. In self-defense, yeah, but even in self-defense, it would be unfortunate. But if that's, you know, and it seems like the Dallas police, and again, this might just be media, weren't as bad as some other police departments. So it's kind of, if something was going to happen, why not go to the police departments that murdered you know, the two cases that happened and, you know, the guys that did it or something, if you're going to do something. Now, I'm not saying that you should do that neither, but I'm just saying that compared to just firing at the Dallas Police Department and picking off cops, that at least there's more, not that it's okay, but there's some more rationality in it. If it was something where they went to Baton Rouge or Minneapolis, I believe was where the other happened, or, I mean, those are just those two. Like I said, there's ones every day. So if somebody went to a police department that for the year, you know, killed 20 people or something and actually went after the people that did it. Now, again, I'm not saying somebody should do that, but it just it makes more sense. Or it's like if somebody's brother was killed by the police and then they went and killed the cop that did it, it would make more sense. But I think that this is some of the frustration, and this is how this person decided to take it out. He said, fuck it, I'm not going to, you know, let this shit continue to go on. I'm going to do something about it. Now, I don't advise people do that. However, at the same time, if it does anything positive, if it stops the police from or makes them... You know, it could go one way or another. I mean, it could make it worse, which is probably what's going to happen. Or it could make cops more scared to pull somebody over or to, you know, fuck with somebody over something stupid. But I think doing something like that is not going to make things any better for anybody. And I feel bad for the kids. If any of those officers had any kids, I feel bad for them because they have no control over it. As far as the wives, if you married a cop, you married a cop, you married somebody in a criminal gang. And when I really think about it, and I'm being rational, I, you know, in a way I feel bad saying that it's, you know, almost that like they deserve it. I'm not saying that they deserve it, but even saying, well, they're part of a criminal gang, so what happens, happens. I feel bad because they're still people. And I don't think that those officers, as far as I know, if they have killed people, then, you know, maybe they, I would say maybe they do deserve it, but as far as I know, they hadn't killed anybody, but they may have. And I can't say that they do deserve it, but I can say that being part of a criminal gang, things like that can happen. But I still, you know, I feel bad. I still feel bad in a way because being a kidnapper doesn't warrant the death penalty. So based on what the average cop does, I, you know, just trying to look at it objectively, that I, you know, I don't think they deserve to die. And again, I don't condone doing that, but at the same time, I understand the frustration of the guy that had done it. Assuming, you know, I mean, I don't know what was in his head. He could have been nuts for all I know. But if it was a self-defense thing, then you're talking about something different. And that's where I think that there's probably a lot of instances where people ended up getting killed that might have been self-defense, and you'll never know it because, of course, the cops will cover that up. So it's hard to really look at something like that, because on one side, like, if I was mad or something, you know, I could say, well, fuck them, they deserve it, or something like that. But at the moment, thinking of it rationally, you know, obviously I don't believe they deserve it, but it's not something that, you know, people die every day, and it's not something that I'm going to lose sleep over or anything like that. And but when it comes to people's lives, like I said, it's unfortunate that he felt that that was his only option and that he did that. So I will say that. And I definitely do not condone or support going out and doing something like that. But if it was a different situation, if it was a self-defense situation, which obviously it wasn't, he was just picking police off, then, you know, I might think a little differently. So I guess that's my take on it. I'm not one of those people that celebrate. You know, you have people that will celebrate when cops die and things like that. Like I said, if I was mad or in a bad mood, I might say, well, whatever, fuck them. You know, they deserve it. They, you know, what they do. But unless they had murdered somebody else, then they definitely, you know, don't deserve it. And I would say it would have been, you know, if he did what he did and the cops lived, it would have been a lot better. Not that would have been a good situation, but that I'm saying, well, I'm not saying cops deserve to be shot neither. I think some cops, I will say a lot of cops deserve to just have the shit beaten out of them, and not to the point of any permanent damage. But that I will say, but I mean, how do you accomplish that? So, especially now that they're hiring fucking gorillas, you know, to be cops, and they tend to hire, they're hiring cops with low IQs. I know that they had mentioned that before as well, that I know an officer or somebody sued because they didn't get on the force because their IQ was too high, which is kind of fucked up. So, so I'm going to play this clip of a woman that's thanking the Dallas police because she feels they saved her life. Although I don't think that's the case. And the other thing that I had thought about is, and this happened in the Boston bombing, and they didn't release it for 2 weeks later. They blamed them for shooting one of the cops who actually lived when they had a shootout. But it was the cops who had shot them by accident. So that could have been the case here, too, where they shot the civilians by accident and then, of course, blame it on him. And that's what I was saying in the in that other shooting as well in Orlando. But I doubt they did a ballistics on the bullet and made sure that it came from his gun. So this is just a quick thank you from her, and then we'll go through the Rudy Giuliani clip because it's something I have to go through with the bullshit that he says. So we'll be I'll play this clip, which is quick, and be right back to comment on the Rudy Giuliani clip.
And I want to show them that we can be unified, you know, that there could be a peaceful march. And we were there, and it was really nice. It was very peaceful. It was very informative. The kids had a good time. They were, you know, my 12-year-olds, like, well, I'm making history. I get to march, you know. We heard a shot, and we all looked because we didn't know what it was, you know, like, because it's so close to the 4th of July. And we all kind of looked, and it was a pause, and there was a second shot. And the police officer, I saw him, kind of tall, hefty, white guy, bald. I remember seeing him. And that second shot, he kind of, as he was going down, he said he has a gun. Run. I'm sorry. I felt the bullet. I don't know if it bounced off the ground or what, but I felt it when it hit me in the back of my leg. And my son, Andrew, had turned around to grab me. Because he didn't, I guess he turned around to see where I was and he went to grab me, but I had already been shot. So I grabbed, tackled him. Police officers had started coming up the block. And one of them, I heard him when he said, is anybody hit? My son said no, because he didn't know I was shot. And I was saying yes, but I wasn't saying it loud enough so my son could hear me because I didn't want him to hear me. And the officer said it again kind of loud, and I said, yes, sir, I'm hitting my leg. And that officer jumped on top of me and covered me and my son. And there was another one at our feet, and there was another one over our head. And there was several of them lined against the wall over there, and they stayed there with us. And I saw another officer. Saw another officer get shot right there in front of me again. That was two. I had never been in a situation like that before. There was hundreds of rounds. Just, I had never heard anything like that before. I'm so thankful for the Dallas Police Department and the whoever else, ACF, I don't know who was down there, but I'm thankful for all of them because they had no regard for their own life. But I'm sorry that it happened. I'm sorry that that person thought that that would be okay, that he thought it would, or that it would solve something. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry that they lost their lives. But I'm thankful. I'm so thankful.
We are back here in New York.
So here is the Rudy Giuliani clip. And I know she says how thankful she was, but she would have been fine, I would think. And who knows who actually shot her. And if she did get hit by the shooter. It would have been an accident. And she had even said it might have bounced up at her. But you're better off staying away from the police, not having them lay on top of her. But here's the Rudy Giuliani clip from MSNBC.
York, Brian Williams here with you for this part of the day's coverage. We are joined by the 107th mayor of New York City, Rudolph Giuliani. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you for having me.
I should add, it'll be a special note to people watching us from New York. Condolences on your former deputy mayor, Peter Powers, who lost his battle yesterday with cancer.
Now, of course, because he's a former mayor of New York City, he knows everything. So,
yes, thank you.
So I'm sorry you're dealing with that. On top of this, it seems to me, Mr. Mayor, we have two crises here, two tragedies, not mutually exclusive, as we were just saying, deaths that are linked by their senselessness. Mm-hmm. We've got Alton Sterling and Philando Castile, two deaths that when you look at them on videotape, no matter what you're feeling about law enforcement, if you're a normal person, it's sickening. Mm-hmm. And what do we do about that?
Okay. Well, what we do about that is we investigate it, we prosecute it, and if they are guilty, and as anyone else, they're presumed innocent, right? If any of the police...
Okay, first of all, as anyone else, they're presumed innocent. It's bullshit, because we are not presumed innocent. We are presumed guilty. We do not get a fair trial. Even if you get a jury trial, you do not get a fair trial because the jury is heavily influenced by the judge who works for the government as well as the DA. But the judge gives instructions to the jury. Now, when it comes to police, of course, the DA does not want to convict police for things like killing someone or excessive force or any of those complaint type things. Maybe for things like, you know, if it's a federal prosecutor and they're selling drugs and things like that, yes. But when you're talking about the same district attorney that works with them all the time, they don't want to convict them anyway. And a lot of times they don't even get to that point. So he talks about it like it's so fucking easy. Of course, they never get convicted, but he talks about it like, oh, yeah, we investigate and we prosecute. And, you know, so how many he talks about the Abner Louima where the guy stuck the plunger, the cop stuck a plunger up the guy. And that I think that was the only guy that was prosecuted under Giuliani when he was mayor. At least for, you know, a crime like that. You know, I don't know about cops selling drugs and things like that. But this, in that, it just, it got out. And I think there was no way where they could cover that up. That was just, and that whole thing was just fucked up. But with the exception of that, I don't know that anybody else got prosecuted. But he says it, well, investigate, you know, then have a jury trial. And, you know, that's what people are doing. But the cops are, one, they're not even getting indicted. So to him, that means they're innocent. Or for the cops that have been indicted, they're found not guilty. People always find cops not guilty. They get to pick the juries, of course, or throw people off. And the district attorney is not going to present a case where they're going to throw the case anyway. So for him to say that is just, it's asinine. It's like, oh, yeah, we'll just do this. And what do you think people have been doing?
If they're guilty, we put them in jail. That's what we do about it. And that happens infrequently. It seems
exactly.
Like it happens a lot because it becomes national news. But if you look at the number of murders of black men in America, that would make up less than one.
No, but it happens infrequently. It doesn't happen infrequently the amount of people where they should go to jail and they don't. And any time that somebody is unarmed or whatever, they never get convicted. And we're not just talking about shootings. What about beatings? What about violation of rights? All that shit.
Percent of the number of murders of black men in America. So the way we deal with it is to put it in proper perspective and be honest about it. What happened last night was the worst attack on law enforcement since September 11.
Yeah.
The people of Dallas should not feel guilty about it. It could have happened any place else in America. Police officers in this country feel they have a target on their back. And they felt that way for over a year now.
Yeah, they feel they have a target on their back. Based off of what? Because people call them out for the rights that they violate? I don't get this feeling like they have a target on their back. If anything, they should feel lucky because they get away with every fucking thing they do.
Police officers Ramos and Lou, who were assassinated on purpose.
In New York City, yeah.
Yeah. And this man made his motives clear. He was killing them.
Okay, two officers that were killed in something like 5 years, whatever. They have a target on their back. It hasn't happened since. It's been, what, a year and a half at least? And because one guy killed two officers, now they feel like they have a target on their back. Hasn't happened since, though. The biggest department in probably the world for a city. I don't know that for a fact. I'm just speculating as far as how big it is, but it's big.
I'm just reading from the police commissioner. He wanted to kill officers, and he expressed killing white people. He expressed killing white officers. He expressed anger for Black Lives Matter. None of that makes sense, said Chief Brown. Now, the reality is we've got to talk honestly to each other. No police officer should act brutally. No police officer should act in a way in which he disrespects anyone's rights. And any police officer who's done that should be punished severely. I personally have prosecuted 70 police officers and put them in prison when I was U.S. attorney, and was instrumental in police officers being prosecuted by Loretta Lynch, by the way, when I was mayor. On the other hand, I also recognize that 75% of, or 70 to 75% of the murder victims in New York City are black. The police have to be present in the black community, not necessarily because they want to be, not necessarily because you'd like them to have them there, but because that's where the murders are taking place. From the time I became mayor and the time I left, murder went down from 1,900 to 500, and then Mayor Bloomberg brought it down to 300. It's now going up again.
Of course. And how many rights did you violate during that time? Daily basis?
In that period of time, we saved, you know, thousands and thousands of mostly black lives by putting white police officers in areas where they were at risk. Now, the New York City Police Department is a non-majority white police department. Mm-hmm. That is by design, starting with Mayor Koch, Mayor Dinkins, me, and Mayor Bloomberg. We accomplished making it a multi-racial, multi-ethnic police department. It is not a majority white police department. At the same token, not every police officer is a perfect person. Some are evil. Some are bad. Most right. are good.
Yeah, you had in the documentary that I mentioned, the 175, that I did a show on last week. You can actually go listen to that on a bunch of places. Go to nonpartisanlibertyforall.com to find all the places. Spreaker is, of course, one of them, or YouTube. But it was a good documentary. I would watch it. But it wasn't just the 175 that was all fucked up. It was also the 177 that was right next to it. And there may have been others as well. But this was, in all fairness, in the, I think Michael Dowd got busted in the early 90s and all that stuff was going on during the 80s.
and the vast majority are good. And I think we have to be honest with each other. And when you talk about Black Lives Matter, well, you know, the black young boy who's killed by another black young boy is just as dead as the black young boy killed by the police officer, except what I just mentioned happens 9, 10, 12, 50 times more.
Yeah, and that is unfortunately true, that if you're going to call yourself Black Lives Matter, and that's the problem in your name, is that if you're just looking at murders by police, which I think is fine because you're talking about the government murdering people. So if you're just looking at murders by police, even if they were just looking at murders of black people by police, you need to call yourself something else. But if you call yourself Black Lives Matter, you're opening yourself up to being called out on, well, how come you don't care about all the people that are being murdered in Chicago, all the black people that are killing other black people? So that's where the name really opens them up to that. Now, if it was something else that had to do with the police, then, you know, that's fine. Like, initially, people were protesting in Ferguson, and this was before Black Lives Matter, or at least no one was calling themselves that in Ferguson that I'm aware of. And people brought up, well, why aren't they protesting in Chicago where, you know, people are getting murdered? And I was like, well, you know, what the fuck? They're protesting the government killing people. So to attack them for what they're protesting is fucked up. But if you call yourself Black Lives Matter, then you're opening yourself up to, well, why aren't you worrying about this as well if you're concerned with black lives? So that is a legitimate point. Now, before that, when there were just protests in Ferguson and they brought that up, to me, that was ridiculous for them to bring it up because they're protesting murders by the government and they weren't, no one was calling themselves Black Lives Matter that I was aware of. So
more than the other. And I think the reason that there's a target on police officers' backs is because of groups like Black Lives,
which is such bullshit that there's a target on their backs. When you look at the amount of police that are being killed, it's still around the same amount. So to say that, especially in New York, where you had one murder of two people, and I don't know what has happened regarding, you know, during crimes, during the commission of a crime where the police aren't targeted, but that's the only targeted murder that, as far as I'm aware, there was one targeted murder of police in, you know, almost 2 years or a year and a half. So this bullshit, and you should look at the posts by police. They even started a Facebook page where they wanted to ban Cop Block and said that Cop Block advocated killing cops and things like that. But if you criticize police at all, you're bad. And, oh, why don't you talk about the good things we do? Or why don't you? And it's like, no, we're talking about the account of, you know, if you're trying to hold police accountable or your police watchers, why would you bring up the good things that they do? That's not your goal, isn't to talk about, oh, well, they visit, and really all the good things that they do is just bullshit for show. Now, you want to show me a cop that lets somebody go when they find them with drugs, that's doing a good thing to me. But they would show, oh, they play basketball with some kids, or they went to the hospital and visited cancer patients. And, oh, why don't you show that? Why would you show that when you're a police accountability organization, or what I do is to expose what the bad things that government's doing and to try to somehow get some freedom back or maintain the small amount of freedom that we have. Now, that's by stating facts, but to the police, oh, it's all bullshit. No cop, none of them come out and say, yeah, there's some bad cops and there's too many bad cops, or even, you know, it's like nothing, they, to themselves, they can't do no wrong. Everything they do is great.
It's a matter. They make it seem like all police are against blacks. They're not. They're the ones saving black lives. Black Lives Matter is not saving any black lives. It's the police officers that are doing it.
The way the governor of Minnesota yesterday seemed to be saying Black Lives Matter in his matter in his own way was something he said that a lot of people struck a lot of people as honest. He said, I don't think had this motorist been white, we'd be talking about this. You have an assassinated driver of a car pulled over for a taillight in the state of Minnesota. The woman recording it for Facebook Live in the front seat, handcuffed despite four rounds in the chest of the guy, and no first aid squad.
Yeah, that's heck of an assumption, though, and not appropriate by the governor.
See, I think that's true in a different way. And I think that's true in the sense that they still would have killed him, but they wouldn't be talking about it because it wouldn't matter. Government media wouldn't cover it. And I've always talked about this video of, I can't remember his name right now, but I had a sister on the show. He was murdered. He was Mexican. And you have a video of him being murdered. And the cop got suspended for 4 days, and that was it. And the cop even lied. And he was, you know, Mexican. So this is not just, this is about police getting away with whatever they do, no matter who it is. It's not just them getting away with it. If it's somebody black, they get away with it. And yeah, I think if it was the same situation and it was a white person, that they probably would have shot them too. Now, I don't know that, but maybe they wouldn't have. It might depend on, like, if how old they were and how they were dressed and stuff like that, if it was a white person. Like, if it was me, which my father's side of the family is Jewish, so I, whatever. But, and he kind of looks, well, he doesn't look like anything now, a bunch of ashes. But he did kind of look like, you know, he has, like, brillowy hair and shit. But, if it was me, yeah, I'd be dead. But I don't know if every white person, if it was, you know, a white person that was a businessman dressed in a suit or something, maybe they wouldn't have done the same thing. So that might be true to an extent. It might be true to a point. But maybe not.
How does the governor know what the motivation is of those police officers? White people get killed also by police officers in the United States. We have white organized crime. We have Russian organized crime. We have Hispanic organized crime groups. They get shot by the police. I prosecuted as many cases involving, you know, white people, the mafia. So how does the governor know that? a confrontation with the police is an inherently dangerous situation, whether you're white or black.
A conversation with the police is a dangerous situation in general. I would look at it more that way, because if you say the wrong thing or you don't obey, it's all about obedience. And there was a white girl that I talk about, not because she's white, just because of how fucked up this is. And this is one of the most fucked up shootings that I've seen, and I've seen a lot, besides that one guy who actually lived, who was pulled over at the gas station and turns around to get his license, and the cop just shoots at him. It was crazy. I think that was North Carolina. That was really fucked up, too. But this, it's about obedience. So I'll tell the story again for people who don't know. Samantha Ramsey, you can look it up. She came from a party in the woods. She was 19 years old and lived in Kentucky. And I remember, you know, when I was a kid, we had keg parties in the woods before we were 21, and you know, we'll go out there to drink and whatnot. So I guess the cops came there. They were driving away when the cop approached. There's dash cam video of the cop walking over to their car while they're pulling away, and then it goes off camera because they're too far away. This fucking cop, I guess he had something with his ankle. So essentially, you can tell that he ran over to the car and maybe they accidentally ran over his foot or something. But he jumped on the hood, shot the girl driving, 19-year-old Samantha Ramsey, who was a preschool teacher, point blank like 4 times. Actually, I think he shot at her 6 times, but he might have shot her in the face and the shoulders. It was 4 to 6 times, and killed her. And he said, well, if I didn't, and he got off, of course, never even went to trial. Got off at the grand jury. He said he felt his life was in danger, that they were going to keep going, and they were trying to run him over. And you could tell, obviously, that's not what happened, because you could see him coming from the side. And obviously, there's no way that he could have gotten in front of the car first. That, and even from the injury on his foot, that he was coming from the side and jumped on the car. And that's because I guess he had told him to stop, and the people that were in the car claimed that they didn't hear him, and they probably didn't. And they all said the same thing, that he jumped on the car. And it's about obedience, because they didn't obey. So if you question a cop or don't obey, and then you try to get, if you run or you try to get away, think of, there was a guy, actually, he was black, didn't pull over, was chased, finally pulled over. When he pulled over, he got out of his car and they shot him, and he was unarmed. I mean, it's insane. And then cops will tell you, you know, they tell you that bullshit story that, well, anybody I pull over could have a gun and kill me. And how many times does that happen? We've already established that it rarely ever happens, because if only, you know, 35 or so cops on average are getting killed a year, and the majority of them are getting killed in shootouts with criminals because they're, you know, chasing somebody who just robbed a store or whatever, and who's shooting at them. Those things don't happen. Yet they're scared to death because of fuckheads like Giuliani who make the statements that he does, or the Southern Poverty Law Center and their training videos. And I'll try to play some of that. And that gets into their head. And then they're shooting people like it's nothing, because they feel scared because they're a bunch of fucking punks. They're scared little bitches. So that whole idea that, and most people believe it too, like, oh yeah, I totally understand. Somebody could shoot you if you pull them over. If that's how you feel, one of two things: don't be a cop or don't fucking pull anybody over.
If you resist, a police officer is immediately going to become concerned for his own life. And the reality is that doesn't matter if you're white or black. If the police officer says to me, put your hands up, and I try to run away, I try to lunge at him, I try to grab him.
You try to run away. So Giuliani's, in his mind, it's okay if you try to run away for a cop to shoot you, which pretty much it is. Again, look at your state's law. I don't know what the law is in every state. I've read Nevada's law. And yeah, if you're running away, if they felt you committed a crime, or it's basically, you pretty much have the right to kill anybody at any time. That's why open carry is fucking dangerous. You know, in Nevada, in Texas, you can't open carry a handgun. But in Nevada, you can, unless they change the law. You can open carry long gun, handgun. You can have your gun loaded in your car. And we don't have any fucking problems with people shooting. I mean, okay, there was that, of course, one incident about the two lunatics who shot, you know, two cops. But I didn't even look at them because I did research on them for the show. And of course, because it happened in Vegas and we talked about it for about a week on the show. And I looked at their Facebook page and all of this shit. And I kind of looked at them, even though they had some libertarian leanings and whatnot. I kind of looked at them more as like lunatics, to be honest. That what they did was just crazy. And then, of course, what happens is we get lumped in with people like that, that are just nuts. But that wasn't a, they got pulled over. That was, they approached two cops that were eating lunch. So that wouldn't matter. Open carry, whatever. They just fucking, you know, obviously they're going to conceal their guns and pull them out because they're about to commit a crime. But the point being is, for the most part, when it comes to legal guns and those type of things, there's not really any problems that I'm aware of. You know, there's not cops getting shot all the time or something like that, or even getting killed. I think, what was it, one cop in 20 years, and then those two that got killed. And that was it. But people want to believe this bullshit. But Giuliani, yeah, if you're running away, if you resist, yeah, if you resist because they're violating your rights, or because you're questioning them. Like when they had asked me to get out of my car, I was questioning why. And why shouldn't they have to explain to me why they're asking me to get out of my car? No, just get out of your car. And have a gun to my head when you approach, too. Because, thanks. And I think they usually carry Glocks as well, which don't have safeties on them. And, yeah, thanks. You know, that could always go off, and you could accidentally blow my head off. So I've had a gun pulled on me by police more than once. Actually, I think it was only twice, but it was definitely put to my head that time because when the cop approached the car, of course, the height of my car and where the gun would have been is right at my fucking head. And of course, that's the only place you could point it anyway. So having a gun pointed at your head and then sitting there and being nice and calm and is not going to happen. Even though I was probably a lot calmer than I could have been.
I don't care if it's white or black. That gun's going to come out. And we got to teach young people that. My father taught me that. When a police officer tells you something, do what he says. It doesn't matter if you're white or black. I do not believe that our police are basically racist. I do believe they are put in contact with the black community, particularly in urban America, not in the rest of America.
So that's about it I have to play on that. But the point is he says the same thing that all cops say is just whatever cops tell you to do, you do. So it doesn't matter if what they're telling you is violating your rights or they have the right to tell you to do what they're telling you. You're just supposed to obey. And I think that is bullshit. And I will continue to think that is bullshit because it is. And that's what got Alton, is that how you say his name? With the Alton Sterling case, essentially what it sounds like to me is that he didn't get on the ground because he was asking them, why, what did I do? And doing that, and of course they accused him of right away being the person, I guess somebody called the police and said someone had a gun, and the guy who called the police said, no, I didn't call, it wasn't him. So they go up to him, of course. He didn't do anything. So what is he gonna say? And you know what? If people don't stand up to fucking police, they're going to get away with whatever they want to do. People need to stand up for their rights, regardless of this bullshit that people like Giuliani and these other cops. And at the beginning of the intro to the show, I have clips from the guy from Cleveland who was the, I believe, director of, what was it for, what do they have for cops? The union, the police union, who had basically said, you know, just listen to cops and do what they say and, you know, you'll be all right. You know, that type of thing. So he kind of said in a way that if you don't listen, then, you know, you could get shot and killed and that's on you, is essentially what he said. And then I had the same the chief of police, I think, of New York, and one of the union reps there, too. And the same thing. you know, about resisting arrest and just following orders and all of that shit. And no, they don't have the fucking right to do that. They don't. They don't just have the right. And you have politicians like fucking Giuliani and other ones that will back them up. And that's where, now he's not in office anymore, but that's where, I think he was an ambassador to somewhere for a while. That's where the one thing that you can't forget, well, I don't like telling people what to do, but that I would suggest you not forget is the fact that the police are on the bottom. Remember that. Now, that doesn't excuse anything they do. But in their mind, oh, we're just following orders. And they're going beyond that, of course, too. But a lot of times, they are following the orders to keep people in line, or like in jails, the way they treat you. They don't come up on with that shit on their own. They treat you like shit because they're trained and told to do that. The same way when they arrest you, they want to make it as bad as an experience as possible. And they'll say because they don't want you to do something again. But when you're arrested, supposedly you're innocent until proven guilty. But the whole thing is you're supposed to stand up for your rights and not just do whatever the police tell you to do. Now, the other guy that's in the intro that was basically telling you, obey police or you might get shot and killed, that was in response to his name is slipping my mind right now, the 12-year-old who was shot to death for having a toy gun. Rice. Tamir Rice. He didn't seem to have any remorse or anything. And that's the other thing, too. These cops, they don't have any fucking remorse when they kill people or when one of their fellow cops kills somebody. So why should people care when cops get killed? So, you know, when it comes down to it, the bottom line is that they join a gang. They know what they're doing when they join that gang. They know they're kidnapping people. They know they're treating people like shit. They know they're ruining people's lives in a lot of cases. And I met a bunch of people that just based on stupid shit, jaywalking warrant, got arrested for the weekend, lost their job, you know, things like that. But they don't care. So why should we care when things happen to them? And we probably shouldn't. And again, I mean, it's hard to say that because it's hard to just feel like, all right, you know, five people got killed, but who gives a fuck? They deserve it. Because I don't think they deserve it. But again, it's like being in a gang or being in the mafia. You might be a good guy and, you know, you still might end up getting whacked and people will say, well, he's in the mafia. He knew the risk he was taking. So that's what happens. And I know a lot of people don't want to hear that. And that probably, you know, bothers some people. But I believe all cops are bad. And I gave my rationale as to why. Because kidnappers are criminals, and that's what they are. Because I did a show, just so people understand, and I did a show on self-ownership. And anybody who believes in true freedom and liberty has to believe in self-ownership. If you don't believe in self-ownership, then you can't believe in true freedom and liberty. You could say that you do, but you don't. So one of the basic concepts of self-ownership, of course, is putting what you want in your own body. No matter how harmful it is, because there are a lot of things that are legal that are harmful, like cigarettes. Alcohol, to me, is one of the worst drugs there is, just because not only how bad it is, I mean, how many people die of cirrhosis, but how it makes you act and all of those things. But still, it's your body. You can do whatever you want with it. Now, that's a right that you were born with. Now, the government, for whatever reason, but we know the reasons, they don't recognize those rights. And they pass laws against them, and they expect the cops to arrest you for them. So if you have drugs on you, they'll arrest you. And it is your right to be able to put drugs in, any drug in your body, and possess any drug. So any cop that arrests you, even though the government says that it's illegal, it's still violating your rights. And they don't have to do it. They can use their discretion. But they don't give a fuck. And they kidnap you and lock you in a cage. And that's criminal. And if they don't want to do that, first of all, they don't have to be cops in the first place. So that's how I can, you know, come to the conclusion. I mean, that's not the only reason. There's other things, like I said, my own personal experience with cops, along with other people I know's experience with cops and research and things like that, along with the fact that all cops kidnap people. Now, if you murdered somebody, I wouldn't necessarily call that a kidnapping. Even though I don't agree with the system, how it is set up, especially the prison industrial complex, the judicial system, which is really the injustice system, and all of that is fucked up. But based on how things are, if a cop arrested somebody for murder, I'm not going to call them a kidnapper or committing a crime for doing that. But if they arrest somebody for drugs, I would. And all cops have arrested somebody for drugs. And they know going in that they have to do that. So if you show me a cop that's letting people go anytime they find drugs and they're only arresting people for real crimes like theft or assault, and I mean real assault, not getting in a fight with somebody, where you both hit each other, or, you know, robbing somebody's house or things along those lines where you actually have a victim, then fine. But you're not going to find a cop that's not doing that. So that's why they're all criminals, as far as I'm concerned. So you have these criminals, and some are worse than others, and they join the gang in blue, and what happens, happens. And again, I don't feel good about anybody getting killed. I think it's unfortunate. But I could say at the same time, maybe those specific officers didn't bring that upon themselves. I don't know what their record is, because, of course, they wouldn't release it anyway if they were bad cops. But, of course, if you're just a regular person and the cops kill you right away, they'll release all the bad things about you. None of the good. So I don't know. But it's like they're paying for what other cops are doing. Now, that might not be it's obviously not fair in that sense, but that's how, I guess, and again, I'm speculating, the Micah Johnson, who's the one who allegedly, because there's a lot of stuff here that just doesn't make sense. But, and the other thing is, I heard that they blew up his body so bad that, like, you couldn't even identify him from his fingerprints. It burnt up his body pretty bad when they blew him up. So that's what the cops are saying. Why we believe, and I'm not talking about this case, I'm talking about, in general, any case, why we just automatically believe, well, I don't, so, or why people automatically just believe what the cops say, what the politicians say, what's reported, because it's really just them, so they say this. And they can come up with their own story and put their narrative together as long as they have people to back it up. And of course, they have that. So it's hard to believe anything that you hear in government media, period. I mean, unless you're there and you witness something. I know that I've read police reports on me, and they were not what happened, because they don't write what happened. I mean, I guess you could say that, well, they deal with so many cases, maybe they just didn't fully remember what happened. I guess that's a possibility, but I doubt it. So it's basically what they say happened based on who's around and how they can manipulate the story. So we have about 15 minutes left, and I'm going to carry this over until to tomorrow. We'll do a part two. But I want to play the Southern Poverty Law Center and their training video, which is very disturbing, if I can find this. And I may be able to, but this essentially, you know, being a cop and being trained by them and watching these videos, and I don't know if I may have to actually look for it. But they have a training video where they go to a father and son had the cops pulled them over on purpose, and they killed them. And they used this in the training video essentially to, I think, scare the fuck out of police. And I think a lot of these things, like things that the DHS has released, and, you know, the on right wing terrorists. I think they even had one on left wing terrorists, although I didn't see that one. I just heard there one existed, so I don't know if one actually does exist. Then, of course, lone wolf terrorist and all this training. They get all this federal training, and that's where the whole Black Lives Matter, which I was talking about earlier, all that's doing is helping for them to officially federalize the police. So then you have an occupying army in the U.S., essentially. And they pretty much have federalized the police for the most part, but not fully. But that's really all they need is to, you know, once they can officially do it, then they can bring it all together. But a lot of this training, because I read about it, how DHS was training the police. You have stuff like this from the Southern Poverty Law Center that they were watching, and other federal training. And of course, all their equipment they're getting from the federal government, they're sharing in asset forfeiture. So they're working with the DEA, the FBI. They, what they're trying to use, and I had mentioned this earlier in the show, and I had also mentioned it when it happened, that the Black Caucus in Congress had actually wrote a letter to Obama to federalize the police. Now, constitutionally, I don't believe they can do that. I believe they would need the permission of the states, I guess. I don't know how they would go about that, but that would be a state issue. So I don't know how the federal government could do that at all. Although it doesn't seem to stop them. Now, I've said before that I don't believe that the Constitution gives gives you true freedom and liberty anyway. However, even if you believe it did, I mean, it's been it's violated on a daily basis, essentially. So it doesn't really matter. What the federal government is doing is just pushing towards more and more control. And I guess with the time we have left, we can talk a little about this and how this is going to be exploited. Because I don't think I'll be able to find this video tonight. Or maybe I will. I had from my old computer a bunch of clips that I don't know if I brought all of them over to my new computer. But I thought I had. So I'm just getting the name wrong of the clip. But that's something I can play on tomorrow's show. But this is something that they will end up using to exploit, as they do with everything. That's one thing that we talk about all the time, that no matter what happens, whether the government has something to do with it or not. And that's why things like false flags make so much sense, because the government does this all the time. They use events that happen to push their agenda. I mean, they did it after 9/11. They tried to do it after Sandy Hook. So this is another, I mean, they can classify this a bunch of different ways to get a bunch of different things done. So, of course, Obama is going to classify this as a mass shooting, among other things. You know, it's a terrorist attack. It's a mass shooting. It's just like what happened in Orlando. So now you have two events in the past couple weeks, or maybe the past month. I forget exactly when Orlando happened, but it wasn't that long ago. It wasn't more than a month ago, where what they would call assault rifles were used. So there's no doubt. And he's already brought up gun control. You know, the first thing he brings up is gun control. A gun was used. This was a mass shooting. Yes, it was a terrorist attack on police. It was this, it was that. But it was a mass shooting as well. So it's another event that can be used. And not only can it be used as a mass shooting event like they do with other mass shootings, but it can be used as a, the police need this to be protected. And even the sheriff of Dallas, he hinted at some things regarding guns and the politicians. And it sounded like, and they were talking about open carry, so it sounded like something where, you know, get rid of open carry. Because in Texas is weird in the sense that unless they've changed the law, you can open carry long guns, but not handguns. So in Nevada, you can open carry both long guns and handguns. But in Texas, and you would have thought, you know, Texas being Texas, I thought they were more free when it came to guns than most places. But the truth is that you cannot open carry a handgun in Texas. And I'm not sure. I remember looking it up because I was in Texas for about a week. I don't recall if you could have your gun loaded in your car. I know you can have it in your car, like drive around, you know, with it in your console. But I don't recall if it can be loaded. It may be where you can have the magazine in, but not a bullet in the chamber. I'd have to go back and look that up again. But Nevada definitely has freer gun laws than Texas does. Because basically in Nevada, especially now that Clark County, you used to have to register your handguns. The rest of the state, you didn't. But the state legislature passed a law saying that counties can't override that law. So now you no longer have to register your handguns, which kind of sucks because all mine are already registered already. So, but any new ones that I get don't have to be registered. And I think that's a positive thing, obviously, because if they ever want to confiscate your guns, supposedly they wouldn't know, they don't know from the background check any of the information about your gun. All they know is that you're doing a background check for a handgun or a long gun. Although with the NSA and all the spying and all of that, I don't know that I believe that they actually don't track that. It's kind of hard to believe, but supposedly they don't. But anyway, this gives him more ammunition, or whoever the next president is, to go after guns, or at least go after long guns. And at the same time, and they can use both incidences as well, it gives them another reason. And somebody even mentioned this, that they want to militarize the police more than they already are. And I mean, the police are out of hand as it is with all the military equipment they have. But now what this does is they're going to do whatever they want to do anyway, regardless of what the people want. They'll keep militarizing if they want to. But the difference is it will help to drum up support of the people. Because something like this happens, even people that don't support the police get sucked into this whole fucking thing. It's really fucked up when you think about it. I mean, it's fine to feel bad for people's families or feel bad that somebody died, but, you know, keep it at that. To distort the facts and the truth about how many police actually get killed and how it's like the 15th, it's not even the top 15 or something most dangerous jobs and all of that is fucked up, because what will happen is some people will fall for that shit. And then you have the people that just support the police already anyway. And even Obama, you know, talking today, he was talking about not black and white people per se, uniting. He was talking about, I think he was talking about that as well, but uniting with the police is what it sounded like he was talking about. And which is crazy, because they're the enforcers for the government. And even if things are good and you live in a free place, you want to keep it that way. You don't unite with the police or the government or, you know, any of these organizations. And I don't know how many people actually take. I know it's less and less on one side. It's more, but it's less. So, like I've said, there's more and more people that see through this shit, but there's more and more people on the other side that are becoming basically slaves to government media or slaves to government. Or, I mean, we're technically all slaves to government, but they believe in the bullshit. So I think you have an increasing amount of ignorant people that buy into the bullshit, where before they might just not even pay attention. And then you have an increasing amount of people on the other side that see things for what they are. So that's good. It's like good news, bad news. But see, those people that buy into the bullshit are the ones that keep the system going, because they're the ones that they can use to rig elections and things like that, because they know that they're the ones they have to convince, and they can easily brainwash and those type of things. It's a very small percentage of people that are, one, even voting anyway, but even get involved to the point where they're changing laws. And usually it's only the laws that give the government more control, like the Mothers Against Drunk Driving that got together. And then what happens is they get backed by some political operative, like I believe Black Lives Matter is one of those groups that has been taken over by progressive operatives. Same with the Tea Party, you know, conservative operatives, and Occupy Wall Street. That's how they get that big. And that's how they get all that attention. And I don't know that they do it to get that, but it gets hijacked, and that's pretty much what happens. That's all the time we have for tonight. Tomorrow we will continue with the police and what happened in Dallas, along with the two shootings that they were protesting. Hopefully between now and then, I'll be able to bring up some more shootings there as well and put together some more information. So thanks, everybody, for listening. Check us out at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, and I will see you tomorrow. Peace.
When we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the law. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go.